Welcome to the seventh session of Practical Ophthalmology Series powered by Mirai Academy in association with Dr. Sabin Sao. This is Ms. Olu Gautam signing in as your host for this session, and I'm so glad to have you all this early morning. So for today's session, we have our topic, uveal and retinal disorders. And to cover up, we have our usual speaker, Dr. Sabin Sao, who is a consultant ophthalmologist and an oculoplastic surgeon. So Dr. Sabin, I welcome you for today's session on the behalf of Mirai and all our participants. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Oluwatam, and I welcome you once again to this seventh lecture of our Practical Ophthalmology series. And today we will be talking about uveal and retinal disorders. So these are the contents for today's lecture. We will start with the uveitis, its brief anatomy, its terminologies, classification of uveitis. Then we will move on to basic anatomy of retina and vitreous, followed by various retinal and vascular disorders, including CRPO, BRPO, CRAO, diabetic retinopathy, hypertensive retinopathy, inflammatory disorders like vasculitis, optic neuritis, acquired macular disorders. And at the end, we'll be talking about other retinal conditions like retinal detachment, retinitis pigmentosa, and retinoblastoma. So let's start with the anatomy of uvea. Uvea is a middle vascular layer of the eye coat. It consists of three parts, mainly iris, this is iris, ciliary body, and choroid, which is the middle layer which lies between retina and sclera. Choroid is a triangular structure which is from where the iris root is attached, and histologically they can be as shown in the picture. Ciliary body have internal limiting membrane, non-pigment epithelium, pigment epithelium, stroma, and supraciliary lamina. This ciliary body has anterior part where finger-like processes are present. This part is called pars ciliata, and the posterior part where the ciliary body is smooth is called pars plana. Iris have four histological layers: anterior limiting membrane, stroma, anterior epithelial layer, and posterior epithelial layer. Stroma consists of iris muscles, which are mainly dilator pupillae and sphincter pupillae. So this sphincter pupillae lies 1 millimeter circular at the margin. It constricts the pupil and is supplied by parasympathetic third nerve, while dilator pupillae muscle is lying at the ciliary zone of iris. It dilates the pupil and sympathetic or cervical nerve supply is present. The ciliary body, the main site of aqueous production is non-pigmented epithelium of ciliary process, and pars plana is the posterior smooth part. So throughout this slides, wherever I am highlighting this Q, that means that this has been asked as a MCQ in some of the entrance examinations. So kindly note them, and this will be useful for those who are preparing for entrance level examinations. So uveitis is defined as an inflammation of a part or a whole of the uveal tract, and it can be classified anatomically into anterior, intermediate, posterior, or panuveitis. Clinically, it can be acute uveitis, chronic uveitis, or recurrent uveitis. Pathologically, it can be granulomatous uveitis or non-granulomatous uveitis. So this classification of uveitis has been given by SON working group, that is standardization of uveitis nomenclature working group. As for this classification, the uveitis can be classified according to the primary site of inflammation. If the primary site of inflammation is anterior chamber, it is called anterior uveitis, which includes iritis, iridocyclitis, and anterior cyclitis. If the primary site of inflammation is vitreous, it is called intermediate uveitis. It includes pars planitis, posterior cyclitis, or hyalitis. If the primary site of inflammation is retina or choroid, it is called posterior uveitis. When choroid is only involved, it is called choroiditis. When only retina is involved, it is called retinitis. When both retina and choroid are involved, depending on which structure is more involved, it can be either chorioretinitis, when choroid is more involved, retinochoroiditis, when retina is more involved than choroid. And another one is the neuroretinitis, when optic disc is also involved. Then another entity is the panuveitis, which means there is an inflammation of all of the interior chamber, vitreous, retina, and as well as choroid. So that is panuveitis. Am I audible?
Yes, so you are audible, but a bit of background
necessary. Sorry. So clinically, uveitis can be of sudden onset or insidious onset. And duration-wise, it can be limited if it is less than 3 months of duration and persistent if it is more than 3 months of duration. So whenever we are saying acute uveitis, it means it is of sudden onset and is of limited duration, that is less than 3 months. When we are calling some disease as a chronic uveitis, that means it is persistent uveitis, which is lasting for more than 3 months, and there is a relapse within 3 months after discontinuation of treatment. And recurrent uveitis means there are repeated episodes separated by period of inactivity without treatment for more than 3 months of duration. So next one is a pathological classification, where uveitis can be classified into granulomatous or non-granulomatous depending upon the type of inflammation and type of keratic precipitates present. Granulomatous uveitis include mainly tuberculosis, leprosy, sarcoidosis, syphilis, while it can also include herpes, brucellosis, onchocerciasis. Non-granulomatous uveitis are most commonly idiopathic in nature, while it can be associated with HLA B27. This group of diseases include ankylosing spondylitis, Reiter's syndrome, psoriatic arthritis. Other diseases are Behçet's disease, inflammatory bowel disease, Lenz-induced uveitis, Posner's Loesman syndrome, juvenile idiopathic arthritis, and Fuchs' heterochromatic iridocyclitis. So we'll briefly now talk about these various clinical uveitis. Acute anterior uveitis, they usually present with pain, redness, dimness of vision, watering, and photophobia. Visual acuity may be reduced to hand muscle or finger count. Conjunctiva, they have circumcorneal or ciliary congestion, which are localized more toward near the limbus. Cornea, corneal edema may be present, and keratic precipitates are present, which are basically the deposits of cells and debris like lymphocyte, macrophages, and cellular debris, and they are present in the posterior part of the cornea, that is endothelium. Anterior chamber may be hazy due to presence of cells, flare. These are the characteristic of uveitis. Hypopyon may be present when there is excessive cells are there and they settle down to form a hypopyon. Fibrinous material may be there and sometimes hyphema may be present. Iris, so characteristic muddy appearance. Posterior synechia, when it is attached to anterior surface of the lens. Iris nodules may be present and loss of iris pattern are seen. In this photograph, we can see there is a presence of conjunctival congestion and there are fibrin in anterior chamber, and you can see there is a settlement of layered hypopyon in the inferior part near the limbus. And cellular reaction is seen in the slit lamp on the high magnification on slit view of 1 mm by 1 mm size. We can actually count these cells in the anterior chamber within the area of 1 mm by 1 mm size. And according to the cells number present in that area, cellular reaction can be divided into 1+, 2+, 3+, 4+, or hypopyon like that. So next is a pupil. Pupil are usually smaller in size in uveitis because of presence of toxic materials or toxins. They induce meiosis. Posterior synechia are present, and when there is when we attempt to dilate the pupil, there is irregular pupil, that is called festooned pupil. We need to understand two terms, secclusio pupilli and occlusio pupilli. Secclusio pupilli means there is ringing synechia, that is 360 degree posterior synechia is present, because of which the aqueous cannot pass from the posterior chamber to anterior chamber, that leads to iris bombae formation, leading to secondary angle closer glaucoma. Occlusio pupilli is the entity when there is an entire pupil is covered by the fibrinus exudate. So there is occlusion of pupil. Lens may have iris pigments on its anterior surface. Intraocular pressure in uveitis may be normal, increased or low. So initially they are increased because of presence of exudate and fibrinous material or proteins, increased protein content of the fluid in the aqueous humor, leading to clogging of trabecular nerve. Intraocular pressure are increased, but later on, after the ciliary sort down occurs, there is less production of aqueous and intraocular pressure starts to become low. Posterior segment may have vitreous opacities or vitritis. These are basically the spillover of cells from the anterior chamber. Iris nodules can be of two types, Kopis nodule and Busaka nodule. Remember, Busaka, B for B, bigger size, and they are located in the base of the iris, while Kopi nodule are smaller in size and are present at pupillary margin. Busaka nodule is characteristic of granulomatous uveitis, while Kopis nodule may be present in either granulomatous or non-granulomatous uveitis. Keratic precipitates, as I have mentioned, are collection of inflammatory cells on the corneal endothelium. They are mostly located inferiorly in triangular pattern with apex pointing up. So this triangle is called Hartel's triangle, and this is occurring because of result of gravity and normal convection of the flow of aqueous. So according to characteristic of KPs, we can know the type of the uveitis also. Like when they are big mutton fat kidneys, they are granulomatous uveitis. They are yellowish in color, are composed of macrophages and epithelioid cell. Fine granular kidneys are present in non-granulomatous uveitis. They are dirty white in color, and lymphocytes and polymorphs are the main contents. Whenever there is pigmented KPs of any color, whether red, brown, black, or whatever is the color, that is suggestive of old uveitis. Stellate KP is present in Fuchs heterochromatic uveitis, which is characterized by fine, fibrillar, and diffuse distribution. As I mentioned, these KPs are usually present in this Hartel triangle in the inferior part. But in stellate KPs in Fuchs heterochromatic uveitis, they are present all over the cornea, diffuse distribution. So that is the characteristic of Fuchs heterochromatic uveitis. Some of the complications of uveitis include complicated cataract, when there is cataract along with the posterior synechia formation, band separate keratopathy, deposition of calcium in the Bowman's layer of cornea, cystoid macular edema is present, most common cause of loss of vision, and the posterior segment involvement of anterior uveitis. Secondary glaucoma may arise and ultimately leading to phthisis bulbi. So how do you treat acute anterior uveitis? Basically, it is inflammation. To reduce the inflammation, you have to give anti-inflammatory drugs, which include topical steroid, 1% predistate. Initially start with 1 hourly and then taper slowly according to response, as 2 hourly, 6 times, 4 times, 3 times, 2 times, 1 times, like that. Cycloplegics usually are given and they relieve the ciliary spasm. And they also help to prevent the formation of posterior synechia, as well as because of their vasodilating nature, they help to flush out the toxins in the uveitis. Systemic steroids are given in form of tablet prednisolone if it is not responding to topical therapy. Systemic non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs like indomethacin, diclofenac may be required to reduce pain and inflammation. Whenever there is IOP is raised, timolol or tablet acetazolamide are given. Clinical pulse. In first episode of unilateral anterior uveitis, systemic investigations are usually not required. Okay, but whenever there is bilateral involvement, are bilateral anterior uveitis, granulomatous uveitis, or recurrent non-granulomatous anterior uveitis, or some systemic features are present, then investigations are required. I'm getting some background noise. Can you, everyone, please mute yourself and just, you can keep your video on if you want, but please mute yourself. Rikesh ji, hello.
Yes, sir.
Can you mute everybody, please?
Yes, sir.
I'm getting some disturbing background noises. Okay. So what are the uveitis workup that are necessary to do? So basically, it consists of complete blood count, including hemoglobin, total TC, DC, ESR, and the random blood sugar, rheumatoid factor, anti-neutrophilic antibody, and ENCA. These are the investigations done to rule out the connective tissue disorders. Okay. And VDRL is done to rule out the syphilis, HIV. Test is done to rule out HIV, chest X-ray, Mantoux test is done to rule out the tuberculosis, and other investigations can be asked according to the systemic disease that we are suspecting. So after this, let's move on to intermediate uveitis, which is also called commonly called pars planitis. Basically, it's an inflammation of pars plana, and primary site of inflammation is vitreous. They are usually bilateral in nature, and it consists of 5 to 15% of all uveitic patient. So most of them, at least half of them, are the idiopathic in nature, while rest can be associated with systemic disease like tuberculosis, syphilis, sarcoidosis, or toxocariasis. Since vitreous is the primary site of inflammation, basically they will have floaters and blurring of vision, which is gradually onset, and pain and redness are usually absent, like in acute anterior uveitis, they are not present. Anterior segment may show some spillover of cells and flare into the aqueous, and posterior synechia may be present. And posteriorly, when we see inflammatory cells are present in the anterior vitreous, this is characteristic feature. In this diagram or in this photograph, you can see it's a slit lamp examination of the slit view, where behind the lens surface, this is a posterior lens surface, behind the lens surface, you can see various opacities in the anterior vitreous. These are the signs of vitreatis. And cystoid macular edema is common complication, which is present in up to half of the patient, that may lead to decreased vision. Other characteristic features are snowball opacities in the vitreous cavity, which are the white focal collection of cells and exudates. Like in the photograph, you can see the white fluffy deposits or collections that are suspended in the vitreous. These are snowball opacities. While if you see these exudates, if they are present in the pars plana, like this part, okay, mostly it is located inferiorly, these are called snow banking or snow bank exudates. Okay, if it is suspended in the vitreous, they are called snowball opacities. If they are present in the pars plana inferiorly, they appear as an exudative block, then it is called snow bank exudate. So these are characteristic feature of intermediate uveitis. So management includes uveitis systemic workup, as I have mentioned earlier, in the anterior uveitis. FFA and OCT is required when we are suspecting cystoid macular edema. Most of the cases are mild and they do not require any treatment, since they are self-limiting in nature. While if they have reduced vision and moderate to severe in nature, then stepwise they are treated as step 1 posterior subtenon steroid, where long-acting steroid in form of injection triamcinolone acetate is given. Second step is a systemic steroid in unresponsive cases, where oral or IV steroids are given. Third step is immunosuppressant, cyclophosphamide, azathioprine, or methotrexate, when they are not responding to systemic steroid and posterior subtenon steroid. And finally, surgical step in form of vitrectomy, cryotherapy, or panretinal photocoagulation may be necessary. So next is posterior uveitis, where the primary site of inflammation is choroid and retina. There, these can be either infectious in nature or non-infectious, or sometimes it can be idiopathic. Infectious causes include toxoplasma, toxocariasis, tuberculosis, syphilis, herpes infection leading to acute retinal necrosis, cytomegalovirus infection leading to CMB retinitis. These are the common infectious causes of posterior uveitis. Other non-infectious causes include collagen vascular disease like systemic lupus erythematosus, polyarteritis nodosa, Wegener's granulomatosis, etc. Sarcoidosis, Behçet's disease, lymphoma, and even masquerades, that is lymphoma presenting as, these are basically the intraocular tumors presenting as uveitis. These are called masquerades. Inflammatory chorioretinopathy, white dot syndromes are some other causes of posterior uveitis. So how do we diagnose them clinically when patient present to us with floater, dimness of vision, and metamorphosis, that is distortion of vision, images? These are the common features, and usually pain, photophobia, redness are generally absent. Okay, the signs, anterior segment are usually normal. Posterior segment consists of vitreous opacity, which are inflammatory cells and exudates. Retina is involved. If retina is involved, it is retinitis. We will see white cloudy area with indistinct margin. And it is called retinochoroiditis when more of the retina is involved plus choroid involvement, and chorioretinitis when more of the choroid is involved plus retina involvement. Another feature is choroiditis. Choroiditis may be either active lesion or inactive lesions. Active lesions are characterized by yellowish or grayish patches with ill-defined margin. Margin are not so distinct. They may be associated with perivascular coughing. You will see the yellow seed-like deposition around the blood vessels. Inactive lesions have sharp margin, and white patches with clumps of pigments may be present at the margin. So if you see these kind of structures that are suggestive of inactive. In this photograph, you can see this, there is a central choroiditis present here. Centrally, it is present in the macula. And this is a disseminated choroiditis, where choroiditis is present diffusely over all the quadrants of the retina. And you can see the these are distinct in margin and have multiple dark pigmentations. So these are the inactive lesions. Okay. Sometimes if these patches are present singly, they are called monofocal or unifocal. And if they have multiple lesions, these are called multifocal choroiditis. Okay. So you will name it according to the involvement of choroid. Another feature is vasculitis, where there is presence of perivascular coughing or seething around the blood vessels. Veins are more involved than arteries. That's why periphlebitis is common than periarteritis. These are basically the cellular infiltrates around the blood vessel causing the perivascular coughing. Like in this photograph, if you see this part of the blood vessel, you will see the exudates or cellular infiltrates surrounding the blood vessels. Okay, so these are the features of vasculitis. Sometimes exudative retinal detachment and optic nerve findings like neuritis, atrophy may also be present. Posterior uveitis are also managed similar to intermediate uveitis with uveitic systemic workup, FFA, OCT as and when needed. For infective causes, we have to treat the underlying cause, and for non-infective causes, if it is mild, we call it mild when there is no visually, if it is not significant and macula is not in danger. Then you treat the underlying cause, find out the etiology and treat the underlying cause. If it is moderate to severe in nature, then subtenon injection triamcinolone is given on, but systemic steroid is the drug of choice. When it is contraindicated, then you can give subtenon injection triamcinolone. And tablet prednisolone 1 to 1.5 milligram per kg body weight can be given for 2 weeks and then tapered slowly according to the response. And if it is not responding to these steroids, then we have to refer for the further work of our immunosuppressive therapy. Basically, methotrexate, cyclophosphamide, azathioprine, cyclosporine are the drugs that are usually given. So I'd like to briefly talk about few specific entities causing the posterior uveitis. Toxoplasmosis is the most common cause of retinochoroiditis. Human are the intermediate host and cat is the definitive host in toxoplasmosis. They have a characteristic headlight in fog appearance when there is presence of vitreitis and the glow of the retina is present. And necrotizing granuloma are seen around the old pigmented scar, and head lesion have characteristic punched out atrophic scar. So these points I have mentioned are very important from MCQ's point of view. So please note them. Next is the tuberculosis, where uveitis is most common presentation of secondary ocular tuberculosis. Disseminated choroiditis is the most common type of uveitis seen. They may have serpiginous pattern of the involvement. Like previously we have seen the choroiditis in the photograph, they were circular in or irregular in shape, but they may have some serpiginous pattern. So these are the characteristic of tuberculosis. Next is toxocariasis, which are always unilateral visual loss is present, seen in older children more than 5 years. They may have three different presentations like chronic endophthalmitis, which may present with leukocoria. So when we talk about the leukocoria, one of the causes toxocariasis as well. Localized granuloma may be the presentation, and peripheral granuloma are most common presentation. So after toxocariasis, next is syphilis. These are usually most common presentation is in early congenital infection, and there is multifocal choroiditis that will lead to characteristic appearance of salt and paper fundus. So this is very important in MCQ point of view. Panuveitis is the term when we use there is an involvement of all compartments of eyes like anterior chamber, vitreous, retina, choroid, everything is involved. Common causes include infectious causes like tuberculosis, syphilis, Lyme's disease, leptospirosis, immune-related disease like sympathetic ophthalmitis, VKS, Bok-Koyanagi-Harada syndrome, sarcoidosis, Behçet's disease. These are the common causes. So Behçet's disease are HLA-B5 associated disease. Usually it is bilateral involvement is present. It is characterized by acute anterior non-granulomatous uveitis with mobile cold hypopyon. Okay, and necrotizing retinal vasculitis is the most common presentation. Systemic features are recurrent painful oral ulcers, recurrent genital ulcers, and skin lesions in form of vitiligo patches may be present. Sarcoidosis is the most common manifestation of these anterior granulomatous uveitis. They can cause panuveitis, which may be bilateral and granulomatous in nature. Perivenous infiltrates have characteristic appearance of candle wax dripping. Okay, like if it is blood vessel, these are like as if there is wax is dripping from the candle. So this kind of feature will be present in sarcoidosis. Next is VKS syndrome. It is bilateral granulomatous panuveitis. Characteristic sunset glow fundus is present due to diffuse retinal pigment epithelium atrophy, but this is in the later stage only. Sugira sign is present where there is perilimbal vitiligo or depigmented lesions are present. Systemic findings include neurological finding, auditory findings, or skin lesions involvement. Next is sympathetic ophthalmitis, which have basically the clinical features will be similar to VKS, but there will be history of trauma. Okay. When there is history of trauma to one eye, that eye is called exciting eye. Okay. And another uninjured fellow eye may also present with the features of uveitis that is called sympathizing eye. Most common cause are accidental penetrating trauma to ciliary body. And they usually develop 2 weeks to years after the trauma. Even as late as 60, 70 years have also been reported in literature. So they are basically bilateral and autoimmune nature, and granulomatous panuveitis is seen. And IV steroid is the main form of treatment. Endophthalmitis is one very important topic. So I would like to mention here, They can be etiologically classified as exogenous or endogenous. Exogenous means something from outside is something infection is going inside from outside. That is post-operative cataract surgery, glaucoma surgery, or post-traumatic or perforation of corneal ulcer. Endogenous means something septic focus infection from the septic focus in other parts of body is coming into the eye through the bloodstream. That is called endogenous endophthalmitis. Common organisms are staph aureus, staph epidermidis, streptococci or propionibacterium acne, and in fungus aspergillus candida, fusarium, mucor are the common organism involved in causing endophthalmitis. Post-operative endophthalmitis can be acute or chronic depending on the time of presentation. If it present within 6 weeks, that is acute in endophthalmitis. If it is after 6 weeks, this is chronic or delayed onset endophthalmitis. Remember, acute in usually ocular pathology, acute means there is 2 weeks of the presentation. Okay, like acute acroscystitis means presentation is within 2 weeks. Chronic means more than 2 weeks. So this endophthalmitis is the only entity where we call acute if there is presentation within 6 weeks. Rest of the condition, the acute means usually 2 weeks. Most common cause for acute endophthalmitis is staphylococcus epidermidis, staph aureus and streptococcus, and chronic are propionibacterium acne or fungi like aspergillus. Clinical features, sudden loss of vision, severe pain, redness, watering, photophobia are seen. On examination, we can see lid edema, congestion, baby present, chemosis, corneal edema, stromal infiltrates, cells, fibrins, and hypopyons may be present. IOP is raised in early stages, and vitreous exudate is characteristically, it has to be present, and purulent inflammation is present. So it can be, in this photograph, if you see, you can see there is presence of corneal edema here, conjunctival congestion, and presence of fibrinous material in the pupillary area, and we can see the settled layer of hypopyon in the inferior part. Okay, so these are the features of endophthalmitis. Management, early diagnosis and treatment is the main key. Investigation, B scan can be done to look for vitreous exudate. When clinically fundus is not visible, vitreous tap is taken and staining and culture of vitreous is done to find out the organism. Intravitreal antibiotics are the main drug of choice, where empirically we have to give broad spectrum antibiotic covering gram positive as well as gram negative organism. Vancomycin is given to cover the gram positive organism, and ceftazidime is given to cover the gram negative organism. This is the first choice, and second choice of drug if it is not available is amikacin for gram negative organism. Dexamethasone can be given where to reduce inflammation, but it is contraindicated if fungal endophthalmitis is suspected, where voriconazole has to be given. Okay. Other supportive therapies or medical therapy include topical antibiotics, systemic antibiotic have very limited role, and topical steroids, systemic steroids are given, cycloplegics and anti-glaucoma are added in the treatment. So surgically, it can be treated with pars plana vitrectomy. These are main two indications. If there is no improvement with medical therapy, or the patient present with severe infection, at the time of presentation only vision is hand motion or PL, then you can straight away go for pars plana vitrectomy. Evisceration is done when there is case is severe and there is no chances of useful vision. Patient is already having NPL vision, then evisceration can be done. Brief anatomy of retina. Now we have completed the uveitis part. We'll now move on to retina. Retina is the innermost coat of eyeball, consists of 10 layers. Outermost is RPE and rest 9 layers are neurosensory retina. These two are separated by a space called subretinal space. Layer of photoreceptors mainly consist of rods and cones. Rods are concerned with scotopic vision and cones are concerned with photopic or color vision. So these are important from MCQ point of view. Bruch's membrane is membrane which separates RPE from choriocapillaries. RPE is the outer blood retinal barrier. It has various other functions as well, like phagocytosis, visual cycle, and even vitamin A, other cycles are also present there. And these are from MCQ point of view, these are important. What are the first other neurons? That is photoreceptors. Second other neurons are bipolar cells. And third other neurons are nuclei of ganglion cells. Okay, you have to remember them for MCQs. Okay, now coming to blood supply, the main branch is the ophthalmic artery, which comes from the internal carotid artery, which is arising directly from heart. And ophthalmic artery gives rise to two branches, mainly one is central retinal artery and another is posterior ciliary artery. Okay, posterior ciliary artery may also have long and short ciliary artery. Inner six layers of the retina are supplied by central retinal artery. Outer four layers are supplied by choroidal circulation from posterior ciliary artery. Macula is mainly supplied by central retinal artery, but sometimes a branch of posterior ciliary artery called ciliaretinal artery may also supply it. Optic disc is supplied by anastomosis between these vessels and called arterial circle of Jean and Haller. Vitreous is a transparent viscoelastic gel with volume 4 ml. Basically, it contains of mainly water, 98 to 99.7%, and some collagen fibrils and hyaluronic acid. In child, vitreous is very dense, homogeneous, and collagen fibrils are not seen. As the age increases, there will be alteration of hyaluronic acid collagen interaction, and there will be liquefaction of vitreous and posterior vitreous detachment are usually seen. Major pathology we see in vitreous are hemorrhage, detachment, vitreatus, and steroid hyalosis, which are the media opacities. Clinically, when you examine the fundus, you have to look if it is the right eye, disc will be present nasally. Okay, this is the right eye, and this is the left eye where disc is present in this side. Always remember, disc lies nasal to macula. So macula is temporal to disc, disc is nasal to macula. And when you examine, if you are examining through the direct ophthalmoscope, you have to, as the retina is focused, you have to look towards the patient's nose, that is nasal side, to find out the optic disc. In the left side, also same, see towards the nose, nasal side, optic disc. When you are examining in the slit lamp with 90 diopter lens, ask the patient to look into your ear to focus on the disc. Like if you are examining the right eye, you hold your lens with the right left hand and see from the when you are seeing, you ask the patient to focus in your right ear so that your focus will directly lie on the disc. And if you want to see the macula, then you have to ask the patient to look directly to focus on the light. Then you will, your view will be focused in macula. Okay, these are some clinical tips which you have to remember. Okay, so moving on with the anatomy, the macula is situated 3 millimeter to disc diameter temporal to disc. It consists of diameter 5.5 millimeter. Center of macula is called fovea, which is most sensitive part of retina, has highest visual acuity, only cones are present. And foveola is the centermost part where inner nuclear and ganglion layers are absent. Optic disc is the first intraocular part of optic nerve. Diameter is 1.5 millimeter. These are some of the things which you will be looking into the disc, like its color, size, shape, margin, vertical oval, optic cup, neuroretinal rim, which is thickest inferiorly, and temporal thinness, that is ISNT rule. It is also known as physiological blind spot of Marriott. Normal CD ratio is 0.2 to 0.4. Peripheral retina has four regions: near periphery, mid periphery, far periphery, and aura ciliata. Aura ciliata is the junction of retina and ciliary body. So clinically, we can examine the fundus by direct ophthalmoscopy, where the image will be virtual, erect, and magnified. Okay, that means the image will be
uh
Hello, Dr. Swamin, are you there? So I guess our speaker has problem in his internet. So I request you all to keep patience and wait for a while until he rejoins again. So until our speaker rejoins again, I would like to announce you that we have came up with the Practical Ophthalmology Series book in association with Dr. Swamin Sahu. So I request you all to take the help from this book to learn more about the practical cases which we encounter daily in our ophthalmic OPDs. So to know the further inquiries, you can mail us or you can contact with Dr. Swamin Sahu. Thank you, everyone. So please have a look at the Practical Ophthalmology Series book, which you can see on the screen. So Swamin sir, are you back?
Yeah.
Right. Continue.
Okay. Okay. Okay, I'm sorry for the interruption because of the power cut, there was issue with the network. So I was talking about the clinical examinations of fundus, where we can use either direct ophthalmoscopy, where image will be virtual, erect and magnified 15 times, indirect ophthalmoscopy with 20 diopter lens, image will be real, inverted and magnified 5 times. Stereopsis, peripheral fundus up to orocerata can be visible. These are some of the advantages of indirect ophthalmoscopy. Slit lamp biomicroscopy examination with 90 or 78 diopter lens can be done. Distant direct ophthalmoscopy is done with direct ophthalmoscope from the distance of 2 feet or 25 centimeter. So investigations related to retina are B-scan, ultrasonography, optical coherence tomography to evaluate the retinal thickness. Fundus fluorescein angiography is used for retinal and choroidal circulation evaluation. Indocyanine green angiography is basically considered better for choroidal circulation evaluation. Other electrophysiological examinations are electroretinogram, which identify retinal dystrophies, electrooculogram, which is used for evaluation of function of RPE, and visual evoke potential, which is used to evaluate the visual pathway. So these are the investigations related to retina. So what are the things that we are basically looking for in the fundus? These are the fundal glow, which is seen by distant direct ophthalmoscopy. You have to note it whether the fundal glow is normal or good, poor or absent. Optic disc, you have to know the size, shape, color, margin, its CD ratio, neuroretinal rim. And in the retinal blood vessels, we have to look for an arteriovenous ratio, which is usually 2:3. That means veins are usually slightly more thicker than artery, but this ratio will be altered when there is tortuosity or narrowing are present. Okay, we also note for bleeding or sheathing of blood vessels. Macula or foveal reflex should be examined for to look for the presence of any edema, hemorrhage, hole or scar. General fundus examination is done to look for hemorrhages, exudate, pigmentation, scar or detachment. Peripheral fundus examination is done by indirect ophthalmoscope and we look for breaks, degenerations or any pigmentations. Okay, so these are the things that you have to look when you are examining the fundus. So moving on to some of the retinal diseases, these are some of the main retinal diseases that you may face clinically, like congenital disorders, inflammations, vascular disease, retinal detachment, degenerative or dystrophy, and tumors. So we'll briefly touch about on these topics. Disc anomalies are the congenital anomalies when there is failure of closure of embryonic fissure, that is disc coloboma. This may be associated with iris, lens, or choroidal coloboma. So another entity is optic disc drusen, where there is abnormal collection of proteins and calcium that accumulate within the optic nerve. And you can see these raised, elevated, whitish lesion over the disc surface or in the margin. So these are the features of optic disc drusen. Another is the optic disc pit, which are the congenital defect. In the photograph, you can see there is a presence of grayish round pit-like structure, which may be variable size. These are the optic disc pit. It may be associated with retinal detachment as well. Tilted optic disc is called when there is a small oval or D-shaped kind of disc is present, and disc margin are usually indistinct in this tilted optic disc. When there is a large disc with a funnel-shaped excavation and blood vessels appear to be emerging radially like a spoke of wheel pattern. So this is called morning glory syndrome. Like this spoke of wheel appearance is there. And medullated nerve fibers, when there is presence of this yellowish structure over the retinal nerve fibers, usually they may be present in superior or inferior pole of the disc as well as in the other part of the retina as well. These are the medullated nerve fibers and they usually do not cause any effect, do not affect any visual decrease. Next is retinopathy of prematurity, which is bilateral abnormality with retinal neovascularization. High risk cases include premature infant, which are born less than 34 weeks, low birth weight less than 1500 gram, normal birth weight should be 2.5 kg or above. Supplemental oxygen therapies, if it is given within first 10 days of life, then there is a high risk of development of retinopathy of prematurity. And these babies should be screening early for the early diagnosis and treatment of retinopathy of prematurity. Basically, the treatment is required when there is definitive progress and photocoagulation or cryotherapy to ablate the vascular immature retina is done. If retinal detachment is present, scleral buckling is done. Some of the details of ROP, these are not so important clinically at your level. These are location of disease, extent of disease, stages of disease according to the fundus findings. This may be classified into stage 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like that. Plus disease, that means vascular dilatation, arterial tortuosity are present in at least 2 quadrants, and aggressive APROP, that is also called RUS disease, which may progress very rapidly and cause deterioration of vision. Inflammatory disorders include retinitis, which is inflammation of retina, vasculitis, inflammation of blood vessels, and optic neuritis, which is inflammation of optic nerve. So we will briefly talking about some of these diseases. So ILS disease is commonly encountered in clinical practice, where is a idiopathic inflammation of peripheral retinal veins. The patient usually complain of painless, dimness of vision and floaters. There is a triad of periphlebitis, occlusion, and retinal neovascularization. This will lead to recurrent vitreous hemorrhage. This is the characteristic feature of Ehlers disease. Treatment in form of oral steroid, pars plana vitrectomy for vitreous hemorrhage and laser photocoagulation is done. In this photograph, you can see the presence of this perivascular coughing, periflebitis, and there is presence of this hemorrhages in the retina. Okay. So next is optic neuritis, which occur due to damage to myelin sheath around the nerve, that is demyelination. There is sudden painless decrease of vision. Decrease of vision may be partial or complete loss of vision, and color deficiency is usually present. They may have three clinical presentations. Number one is the papillitis. When you see this, the disc is edematous and disc margin is blurred like this. There is a presence of papilledema or disc edema or hyperemia of disc is present. So this kind of feature is called papillitis. Another one is neuroretinitis, when there is presence of disc edema as well as presence of this macular star-like pattern of deposition of hard exudate in the macula, and disc edema is present. So this is called neuroretinitis. Next is retrobulbar neuritis. That means the optic nerve, which is lying behind the eyeball, is involved. A disc appears normal and there is pain on eye movement. This is the characteristic feature of retrobulbar neuritis. They are basically treated by IV corticosteroid followed by oral steroid. And only oral steroids should never be given, rather it is contraindicated because of presence, increased risk of multiple sclerosis. So treatment of choice is always IV methylprednisolone for 3 days, followed by oral steroid for rest 11 days. So total of for 2 weeks of treatment is given for this optic neuritis. Okay. Vascular disorders, there may be artery or venous occlusions. Venous occlusions are more common than artery occlusion, and diabetic retinopathy, hypertensive retinopathy may be other vascular disorder, which we'll be talking briefly. Okay, central retinal vein occlusion and branch retinal vein occlusion, they are occlusion of major outflow channels. Major risk factors are hypertension, heart disease, primary open angle glaucoma, and diabetes. Clinically, they present with sudden painless loss of vision. And on clinical examination, you can see dilated and tortuous veins, retinal hemorrhages, macular edema, disc edema, cotton wool spot, and neovascularization of iris leading to neovascular glaucoma. In CRVO, the presence of this neovascular glaucoma occurs usually 3 months after the CRVO. So that's why it is called 100-day glaucoma. CRVO, central retinal vein occlusion, these features will be present in all 4 quadrants, giving the fundus a splash tomato or tomato ketchup or blood and thunder appearance. Okay, these are important from MCQ's point of view. BRVO have segmental distribution, and most common segment involved with the superotemporal sector. Like in this diagram, you can see there is a presence of retinal hemorrhages in the superotemporal part with the presence of this whitish cotton wool spots. Okay, and only the superotemporal part is involved. Inferior and nasal part of the blood vessels are normal. So that's why this is a diagnosis is BRVO, that is branch retinal vein occlusion. Like in this photograph, you can see there is a presence of hemorrhages all over the retina in the superior, inferior, nasal, as well as temporal quadrant. And if you see, this is the tomato ketchup or tomato splash appearance or blood and thunder appearance. That is, hemorrhages is present in all 4 quadrants. So this is a feature of central retinal vein occlusion. Investigations is fundus fluorescein angiography, which is done to divide it into ischemic and non-ischemic CRVO. Treatment include laser photocoagulation, intravitreal injection, IOP lowering agents, and treatment of systemic disease or causes. Okay, so next is central retinal artery occlusion or branch retinal artery occlusion. These factors include old age, atherosclerosis is the most common cause, risk, high cholesterol, diabetes, hypertension, or other risk factors. We have to understand 2 terms embolism and thrombus, which can cause occlusion of lumen of blood vessel. Embolism is termed when the blood clot comes from far from other parts of the body, like from heart, lungs. Thrombosis is when the blood clot is formed locally in the site of the blood vessel. Okay. So most common cause of CREO is atherosclerosis related thrombus. 20% of all may be carotid artery embolus, which is Kollenhorst block, the term used for cholesterol embolus. Calcific embolus or fibrin embolus may be present. 5% of cases include giant cell arteritis, SLE, and thromboembolic disorders. Symptoms: unilateral sudden painless loss of vision. Signs: white edematous milky white retina is present, and cattle track appearance or box carrying fundus is the typical feature. Cherry red spot at macula is seen in 90% of cases, and this is the earliest sign. RAPD may be seen, and consecutive atrophic optic atrophy may be seen in chronic cases. So this is a feature of CREO and BREO. Segmental involvement, as I mentioned earlier, will occur. In this photograph, you can see the milky white appearance of whole of this retina, and there is a presence of reddish structure at the macula. This is a cherry red spot. Okay. White narrow arteries, diagnosis is CREO. So this cherry red spot is not 100% characteristic of CREO. You have to remember some other causes of cherry red spot, like CREO is one of the cause. Trauma, blunt trauma causing Berlin's edema is also another cause. Nemanthic disease, GM1 gangliosides, Tay-Sachs disease, and Sandow's disease are the other causes. To remember it easily, you can use this mnemonics: cherry trees never grow tall in Sandow. Okay. CREO, trauma, meningitis disease, GM1 gangliosidosis, Tay-Sachs disease, and Sandow's disease. This is a very important MCQ question. CREO is an ocular emergency, and it can be treated by immediate lowering of IOP is required with mannitol or acetazolamide or AC paracentesis. Ocular massage is indicated. Vasodilators like sublingual isosorbate nitrate and carbazone inhalation is indicated for vasodilatation. Fibrinolytic agent and transluminal NDR laser embolysis are other treatment modalities. Next, very important topic is diabetic retinopathy. This is basically a microangiopathy involving the retina. Risk factor: duration of diabetes very important. Longer the duration of diabetes, more the risk of chances of retinopathy being present. And poor control of diabetes, hypertension, renal disease, and other systemic conditions like high cholesterol, anemia, smoking, obesity are the risk factors for developing diabetic retinopathy. It can be classified into non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy, proliferative diabetic retinopathy, diabetic maculopathy, and advanced diabetic eye disease. So what are the clinical features that we see? How to diagnose this diabetic retinopathy? We have to find these clinical signs. Number one is microaneurysm, which is the earliest sign of diabetic retinopathy. They are basically seen as tiny dot-like structures in the retina, and this occur because of localized dilatation of the capillary wall. Sometimes they are very difficult to see, and you can see them in slit lamp examination and the high magnification. Retinal hemorrhages may be present in two forms. One is a superficial flame separate hemorrhage, also called known as splinter hemorrhage, and another is deep dot and blot hemorrhage. Superficial hemorrhage, they appear like a flame shape. Okay, this kind of flame like shape is present, so that's why it is called flame separate hemorrhage. Dot and blot hemorrhage are circular in nature. If it is small dot, that is dot hemorrhage. If it is larger, then it is called blot hemorrhage. Okay, these are the dot and blot hemorrhage. Venous beating is present, is called when there is bead like appearing, that is irregular dilatation and constriction of blood vessels like this, then it is called venous beating. So this is a feature of severe diabetic retinopathy. Another feature is intraretinal microvascular abnormalities, where there is a presence of shunt between the artery and vein, like in this area is a presence of shunt. Okay, so that is called IRNA or intraretinal microvascular abnormality. It is also a feature of severe NPDR. exudate may be present either in form of yellowish deposits like this. This is called hard exudate, or it may be white fluffy deposits. These are called soft exudate, which are also known as cotton wool spots. Hard exudate is basically lipid deposit, and soft exudate is infarction of retinal nerve fiber layers. So depending on how many of these features are present, it can be classified into mild, moderate, severe, very severe. Like this is called ETDRS classification of NPDR. Mild, if there is only microaneurysm is present, or retinal hemorrhage, or hard or soft exudate present. If these features are present in two or three quadrant, then it is called moderate. If it is present in all four quadrant, it is called severe. Or if there is presence of venous bleeding in two quadrant or edema in one quadrant, that is also called severe. This is called 4-2-1 rule. If two or more of these features of 4-2-1 rule is present, that is very severe NPDR. So next, you have to understand the term clinically significant macular edema, which has three criteria. Number one, any edema within 500 micron of center of fovea, any hard exudate present in this center along with the retinal thickening, or any retinal edema of size 1 disc diameter and at least a part of which lies within that 1 disc diameter of center of fovea. So these are the three main criteria whether to call it CSME or not. Basically, very important thing is if you see anything yellowish deposit in the macula, that is CME. Remember that. Like in this case, you are seeing this yellow deposit in macula, that is CSME. Other features are superficial flame separate hemorrhage is present in different quadrants. Okay, dot and blot hemorrhage is present in all four quadrants. This is the whitish color of cotton wool spot or soft exudate. This is hard exudate, yellowish in color. So this is a feature of NPDR, that is very, it is severe NPDR, presence in all four quadrant with CSME, presence of clinically significant macular edema. Proliferative diabetic retinopathy is called when there is presence of either one of the following: neovascularization, vitreous hemorrhage, or pre-retinal hemorrhage. Neovascularization, if it is present within 1 disc diameter area of this disc, then it is called NVD. Suppose this is disc, and within 1 disc diameter area, if any neovascularization is present, then that is called NVD. If it is present beyond this 1 disc diameter area, that is called NVE, neovascularization elsewhere. Okay. In proliferative diabetic retinopathy can be classified into early, without high risk characteristic, or advanced, that is with high risk characteristic. So what is this high risk characteristic? This is presence of neovascularization of disc of size up to 1/3 of disc size, or presence of any NVD with pre-retinal hemorrhage or vitreous hemorrhage, or presence of NVE with associated pre-retinal or vitreous hemorrhage. Basically, any hemorrhage is there in the retina or with NVD or NVE, then that is proliferative high risk characteristic. Okay. Sometimes you may not be able to visualize the disc, blood vessel, retina like this. Very hazy view may be present. This is a feature of vitreous hemorrhage. Depending on color, if it is fresh hemorrhage, it will be red in color. Old hemorrhage, it will be gray in color. Sometimes you can see this board separate horizontal structures which are obscuring the posterior part of the retina with the characteristic this layered will be present. Okay, this is a pre-retinal hemorrhage, also known as subhyaloid hemorrhage. Okay, advanced diabetic eye disease are characterized by vitreous hemorrhage, pre-retinal hemorrhage, tractional RD, or neovascularization of iris. Treatment for diabetic retinopathy include systemic control, that is control of blood sugar, control of hypertension, anemia, cholesterol. These risk factors should be controlled. And other treatment modalities are pan-retinal photocoagulation, intravitreal injection, basically injection Avastin, bevacizumab, or ranibizumab is given, and surgery, pars plana vitrectomy is done. So when do you screen for this diabetic retinopathy? It should be done 5 years after onset, 5 years after onset in type 1 diabetes mellitus, and at the time of diagnosis in type 2 diabetes mellitus. How do you know whether it is type 1 or type 2? If the patient is taking insulin, that is type 1 diabetes mellitus. If patient is having only oral medication, that is type 2 diabetes mellitus. Simply remember like that. Follow-up schedule is no diabetic retinopathy or mild diabetic retinopathy. 1 yearly follow-up is recommended. If there is moderate NPDR, early or every 6 monthly follow-up is recommended. Severe cases, every 3 months. PDR with high risk characteristic, then frequent follow-up is recommended. Okay. So for the patients who are coming for the first visit to you for diabetes screening or them, very easily you can tell them to go for dilated fundus examination every 6 months or something like that. Okay. If you say every 6 months, then they will try to come within 1 year. So these are some of the important points which are important from MCQ point of view. Most common cause of loss of vision in NPDR is diabetic macular edema. Cause of loss of vision in PDR is vitreous hemorrhage. Cause of blindness in diabetic retinopathy is retinal detachment. So this may be asked in various MCQs. Hypertensive retinopathy can be graded according to clinical feature. There's one classification, Keith Wagner Barker. It's basically a narrowing of artery in grade 1. Focal narrowing with arteriovenous nipping is present in grade 2. In grade 3, hemorrhages and exudates are present along with these features. In grade 4, optic disc swelling, papillary edema is also present. There are some named signs like Salus sign, which means deflection, Bonnet sign, which means banking, and Gone sign, which means tapering of veins at the AV crossing. Malignant hypertension is characterized by retinal edema, corneal spot, hard exudate, and macular star. Hypertensive choroidopathy is seen in malignant hypertension, ischemic spot or choroidal infarct, and serous streak or due to fibrinous necrosis are the features of hypertensive choroidopathy. And hypertensive optic neuropathy may also occur in malignant hypertension. So in this photograph, you can see if you note this blood vessel carefully, you can see there is a narrowing of some part. Okay, there is a focal narrowing in this part of the blood vessel. So this is, what do you call this? This is called arteriovenous narrowing or arteriolar narrowing, focal narrowing is present. And this is a copper wiring, which means because of presence of arteriosclerosis of wall of the blood vessel, this orange color hue is present. That is called copper wiring. As it progresses, if it is progresses, then there will be more arteriosclerosis of blood vessel occur. Then whole of this blood vessel will appear white in color and no blood will be seen. Then that is called silver wiring. Okay. Copper wiring progresses to the silver wiring. Okay, this is arteriovenous nipping, where there is usually this vein and artery, they run side by side, but sometimes they may cross each other, and this artery may be crossing the vein like this, and this may press the vein, leading to, okay, this artery which is crossing the arteriovenous crossing, it may also press the vein and cause problems. Okay, so this is arteriovenous nipping. In presence of exudative deposits, hard exudate deposits in the macular area, that is macular star. So in this photograph, you can see there is a presence of multiple features of hypertensive retinopathy. Number one is this is hard exudate is present. This whitish thing is white soft exudate or a cotton wool spot. The disc margin is clear in this nasal part, but it is blurred in this temporal part. Is disc involvement as well. This is a copper wiring. This is almost copper like hue of the blood vessel is seen. Superficial flame separate hemorrhages are present here as well as in peripapillary area, and some dot and blot hemorrhages or dot like structures are present. So these are all the features of hypertensive retinopathy. And once the disc is also involved, it is always grade 4 hypertensive retinopathy. So next is age-related macular degeneration, which is commonly seen in age group more than 50 years. History of smoking is important. Family history of ARMD and dietary factor, high fat intake are the risk factor for developing ARMD. It is one of the major cause of irreversible blindness in developed countries. What are the clinical features? Basically, it can be dry AMD or wet AMD. Dry AMD is characterized by drusen. Wet AMD is characterized by choroidal neovascular membrane. This is more dangerous because it may cause sudden or rapid loss of vision, but seen in only 10% cases. This is less dangerous, have gradual loss of vision or no loss of vision, and is present in around 90% of cases. What is drusen? Drusen are basically the extracellular deposits, eosinophilic deposit, that lie between RPE and Bruch's membrane. Clinically, they appear as round or oval shaped, this waxy yellow color of deposits of various size and shapes. Okay, according to this size, it can be small drusen, intermediate drusen, or large drusen according to the size. And hard drusen, well defined, small in size, and soft drusen are less distinct and intermediate to large in size. So these are the clinical features. How do you treat them? Smoking cessation is very important. Antioxidant supplementation should be given. And once CNVM has developed, choroidal neovascular membrane has developed, intravitreal anti-VEGF agent like intravitreal bevacizumab or Avastin is the treatment of choice. Photodynamic therapy can also be done. And in burnt out disease where there is already vision is very much affected, then low vision aids can be given for rehabilitation of patient. Next entity is central serous retinopathy. Where there is collection of fluid in the subretinal space leading to neurosensory detachment at macula, usually unilateral. They are present in male between 20 to 40 years of age. Mostly the people involved are type A personality with very competitive and very perfectionist type of nature. Stress, smoking, and steroids are other risk factors of central serous retinopathy. So how do you know diagnose them? Patient usually come with the complaint of blurring of vision, micropsia or metamorphosia. Metamorphosia is distortion of image and micropsia is object is perceived smaller. It's confirmed by OCT where neurosensory retina and RP, there is collection of subretinal fluid. FFA is very characteristic. Ink blot appearance is seen in 10 to 20% case. Smoke stack, umbrella, armstrong appearance is seen in 80 to 90% of cases. So this is a photograph where you can see there is a presence of dull reflex in the macular area. And if you do the OCT, there is a presence of subretinal fluid. Similarly, in this photograph also, it's the same. This is also central serous retinopathy. Subretinal space fluid collection is there. Okay. So how do you treat them? Spontaneous resolution occur in most of the cases. 60% resolution occur in 3 months, 80% in 6 months, and within 1 year, every cases have resolution. But sometimes there may be recurrence, and recurrence is seen in 40% of all cases. If there are multiple recurrences leading to visual field defect, already one eye is already vision has been decreased, or serous detachment is present for more than 3 to 4 months, then laser photocoagulation is given. Remember, never give steroid in these cases because they act as a risk factor for CSR. Next is a macular hole where there is a presence of full thickness defect in the retinal tissue. Clinically, how do you see them? Clinically, you will see this. Macular area, there will be a round, well-defined, punched out defect in the center. Okay. For diagnosis, you have to do the OCT. OCT, you can see clearly the full thickness defect. Treatment, which is PPV with ILM peeling is done. Okay. Cystoid macular edema is some of the risk factors are post-cataract surgery, intraocular inflammation, retinal vascular disease, and vitreomacular traction. Basically, in the macular area, there will be thickening, dull reflex will be there. In OCT, there will be intraretinal thickening. This thickening is very much significant with cystoid spaces. Like these are the cystoid space, like circular black thing. These are cystoid space. And FFA, characteristic flower petal or petaloid appearance of leakage is seen in macula, which is important. How do you treat them? Treated with steroid or non-steroid anti-inflammatory drugs, carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, or in persistent cases, antibenzaphagin, or if it is associated with traction, then pars plana vitrectomy has to be done. Next is best macular disease, where you can see this yellow yolk-like feature in the retina. This is also called sunny side up or vitelliform lesion. Vitelliform means egg-like lesions. Yellow egg-like lesion is present in macula. Usually they do not cause impairment of vision, but sometimes there may be even this egg may rupture, causing scrambled egg appearances, and in the macula there sometimes they may cause decrease in vision as well. Investigation of choice is electrooculogram, and characteristically electroretinogram value is normal. Okay, in MCQ point of view, you have to remember this Arden ratio, which is typically less than 1.5 or 150%. This normal Arden ratio is 1.8 or 180%. And in this case, there will be decrease in Arden ratio. You have to remember this for MCQ point of view. Retinal detachment. Next is the one big topic. I think we'll briefly go through them and quickly finish them. Retinal detachment is separation of neurosensory retina from RPE. Basically three types of there. Regmatogenous RT, when there is presence of break. Regma means break. Okay. Why do breaks occur? They occur because of retinal degeneration, like lattice degeneration or high myopia or trauma. That's why in cases of patient with high myopia, you should always ask them to do indirect ophthalmoscopy and fundus examination periodically. Cataract surgery with PCR or FAKR, these are some of the risk factors. And another one is tractional retinal detachment. Why do they occur? Because of mainly of diabetic retinopathy, trauma, vascular occlusions, or cataract surgery with PCR and vitreous traction. They occur because of contracting vitreoretinal membrane or fibrovascular membrane, which are pulling the retina away from its normal attachment, causing the retinal detachment. Another one is exudative RD, which are usually seen as the smooth, elevated, dome-shaped lesions. Why do they occur? Because of uveitis, mainly VKS. Choroidal tumors are the important causes, like malignant melanoma, retinoblastoma, metastasis. These are some of the common causes of exudative retinal detachment. So how do you know or clinically diagnose patient? All of them usually come with the feature of flashes of light, that is photopsia, floaters, field defect, or something falling into cotton-like thing is falling into the eyes, or sudden painless loss of vision will be there. Intraocular pressure are usually normal, RAPD are present, and in distant direct ophthalmoscopy, gray reflex is present. So clinically, what do you see? Fundus examination, in regmatogenous RD, you will see retinal break, mobile retina with fold and convex surface. In tractional RD, you will see taut immobile retina and concave surface of the retina, and vitreoretinal traction will be there. Exudative RT, you will see smoothly elevated convex surface retina with bulla or choroidal mass. Okay, and vitreous changes, some pigment release may be there. And if there is pigment in anterior vitreous, like tobacco dusting, this is a feature of fresh retinal detachment. Subretinal fluid, characteristic shifting fluid is the hallmark of exudative RT, and clear fluid is present in regmatogenous and tractional retinal detachment. So how do you treat them? Prophylactic barrage laser is done in symptomatic breaks and horseshoe tear or superiotemporal tear. So this is the most common cause, horseshoe tear, and this is the most dangerous cause, that is superiotemporal tear is most dangerous. Retinal detachment, pars plana vitrectomy plus pneumatic retinopexy, that is gas tamponade in form of C3F8 or SF6. Gas is usually used, or sometimes silicone oil may be used for tamponade. Endo laser is usually done, or scleral buckling may be done. Treatment of underlying cause of the systemic disease is done, and enucleation is done in presence of intraocular tumor with no chances of useful vision. Next is retinitis pigmentosa, which is a rod cone dystrophy, most common hereditary fundus dystrophy. Usually they have sporadic is most common cause. Inheritance, other may be autosomal dominant, autosomal recessive, or X-linked. Most common symptom the patient present with is night blindness or nyctalopia. This is the earliest feature, and loss of the peripheral vision may be there. This is a classical sign. Okay, classical triad of the sign is there. So what are the classical triad of sign? This is a presence of pigmentation in the retina, that is bony spicule pigmentation, waxy pallor of the disc, and arteriolar narrowing, like as if there is an artery is almost not visible here. Pigmentation, pale disc, and narrow blood vessels. These are the characteristic features of retinitis pigmentosa. So how do you treat them? There is some recent advancements of retinal prosthesis system which are being developed and not commonly used yet, and low vision aid is given for visual rehabilitation. Next is retinoblastoma, which is the most common primary intraocular malignancy in childhood. 60% have non-hereditary causes and 40% have hereditary. You have to remember this gene, that is RB1 gene mapping to 13q14 chromosome, that is tumor suppression gene. Remember, 13 is very unlucky number. That's why 13 gene in 13 chromosome, if that is affected along with short arm of the 14, that is retinoblastoma will occur. Knudsen two-hit hypothesis is used to explain the genetic pattern of retinoblastoma, which states that both of the alleles has to be involved to produce that disease. If hereditary, if one of the alleles damaged and you get the second hit acquiredly later, then also you can develop retinoblastoma. Most of the retinoblastoma cases present within 3 years. Common age of presentation is 1.5 year to 2 years of the age. They are bilateral in 30% cases and unilateral in 70% cases. 85% of the heritable retinoblastoma are bilateral, but sometimes they can be unilateral. So unilateral retinoblastoma can either be hereditary or non-hereditary in nature. So this is very important. How do they present? How do you diagnose the retinoblastoma? Leukochoria, that is white reflex of eyes, are the most common clinical feature. Strabismus is the second most common presentation, and most commonly esotropia is seen. Secondary glaucoma, orbital inflammation, proptosis, pseudouveitis, retinal detachment, these are the other common clinical presentation of retinoblastoma. The growth pattern may be exophytic. It is if it is growing towards the choroid. Okay. Suppose this is a retinoblastoma mass. If it is project into the vitreous as a mass and grows in the vitreous, this is called endophytic growth. And if it is progressing outward, okay, if it is progressing outward, then this is called exophytic growth. Most common route of spread is through this optic nerve. It can reach to intracranial extension as well and leading to death of the patient as well. That's why it is very important to diagnose it early to save the child's life is the most priority rather than saving the eye of the patient. That's why enucleations are commonly indicated in these cases. From MCQ point of view, secondary malignant neoplasm most commonly associated is osteosarcoma, and most common neoplasm encountered associated with retinoblastoma is pineoblastoma, which is one kind of a brain tumor. Retinoblastoma can be classified into A, B, C, D, E according to its size and involvement. If it is small in size, less than 3 mm, it is group A. If it is bigger, more than 3 mm, it is group B. If there is vitreous seed are present, then it is group C. If there is diffuse involvement of subretinal as well as vitreous seed more than 3 mm, it is group D. And E is extensive retinoblastoma. That is group E, which occupies more than 2/3 of globe. If there is a presence of massive intraocular hemorrhage or secondary neovascular glaucoma is present, or eye is already going into phthisis or orbital cellulitis is present, then that is group E. So how do you treat them? Treatment is done according to staging. The different modalities are chemotherapy, radiotherapy, and cryotherapy, laser photocoagulation, or thermotherapy. But sometime when the tumor are very large and it covers almost more than half of the globe of the eye, then enucleation is indicated with minimum optic nerve stump of 10 millimeter. Okay. Remember, enucleation is done. Evisceration is never done in case of intraocular tumor. Investigation, most important characteristic feature is calcification. whenever there is any tumor with the classification, always remember it may be retinoblastoma, either in CT scan, MRI scan, or ultrasonography. Presence of calcification indicates it may be retinoblastoma. So this is the last point, which is a common causes of leukocoria, which is important in MCQ point of view. Number one cause is congenital cataract, retinoblastoma, retinopathy of prematurity, persistent hyperplastic primary vitreous, choroidal coloboma, or toxocariasis. These are the common causes of white reflex. So that will end our session today. And I think Ms. Sologortham has already announced this. We are coming up with this publication, Handbook of Practical Ophthalmology for Ophthalmic Practitioner. Based on these lectures, I will be compiling the notes, and with further addition of other topics as well, this book will come soon. So that's all.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sabin. So I guess with this, we have concluded our previous talk. So any questions, if you have, you can type it down in our chat box. Dr. Sabin is more than happy to answer all of them.
Can I share? Where can I share my screen? Can you see the question in my screen? You're not able to see, I guess, huh?
Sir, we can see in our screen, but we can see in the Zoom chat box.
Zoom channels, yeah, okay. So the one question I can see from Ranjana Gupta is, sir, why do we need to do FFA OCT in uveitis? What should it be done and how does it help in management? Okay, FFA and OCT are done basically to look for cystoid macular edema, which is present in almost half of the cases of intermediate uveitis and posterior uveitis. So if there is presence of cystoid macular edema, usually they have low vision as well. That's why they need urgent treatment, and it helps in management because you have to treat that condition as well. Okay. Next question is by Deepak Kuswa. What are the types of macular hole? Macular hole has it can be classified into four types according to GAS macular hole classification. Number one is stage one with impending macular hole, where there is lamellar hole, and other stages are stage 2, 3 have full thickness macular hole. So these are basically, you have to remember like that. There may be lamellar or partial macular hole, that is stage 1 and 2, and full thickness hole, that is stage 3 and 4. Yeah, I think that's all. Do we have any other questions?
Yes, sir. Can see more questions in YouTube.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, in the YouTube, I can see some question by Roshan. What is lattice degeneration? Can be treated with Barra's laser? Yes, lattice degeneration is one of the peripheral retinal degeneration which is present in the peripheral part of retina. Usually, they are not visible with direct ophthalmoscopic examination or in slit lamp examination. They can be visualized from the indirect ophthalmoscopy only, with or without scleral indentation. And if lattice degeneration as such is not symptomatic and not causing any trouble or any problem, they may be left untreated. But if they are symptomatic and there is a risk of, because there is a risk of formation of retinal hole or retinal tear, then you have to do Barra's laser. Barra's laser is basically you give laser shots around this lattice so that further retinal hole or tear does not occur or they do not progress. So that is the main treatment. Okay. Next question by Murali Sasar. What are the visual involvement in hypertensive retinopathy? What are the visual involvement in hypertensive retinopathy? And the question is not so clear. By what I understand, what are the causes of why visual decrease occur in hypertensive retinopathy? If you mean to ask like that, then if there is a presence of macular involvement, or if there is a presence of hypertensive choroidopathy, or if there is a presence of hypertensive optic neuropathy in form of either papilledema or this optic neuropathy, then visual decrease may occur. And even in cases of malignant hypertension, there may be retinal hemorrhages leading to even vitreous hemorrhages may occur. That will also lead to visual loss in case of hypertensive retinopathy. I think that will answer the question. Next question is when the book is coming. Book will come soon and we will keep you notified. Please stay tuned. Hopefully it will come within next 3-4 months. I think that will answer all the questions in YouTube.
Almost all questions. Yes, sir. So we have almost answered all the queries. So if you have any more further queries, you can type it down to the MayVI official either at gmail.com or to our WhatsApp. We will forward to our speaker and he will reply in his nearest lesser time. Mm-hmm. So with this, we are to the end of today's talk. And I would like to thank you all for coming up with your queries and tuning in for today's session. So anything you want to add, Dr. Savin?
Yeah, I can see one more question from Roshan. What is WWOP? This WWOP is basically a white without pressure. Okay, in the retinal peripheral degeneration of retina, one of the term used is this white. If you see any whitish lesion in the retina, that may be white with pressure or white without pressure. This is little advanced for you all. But basically remember, white lesions may be either white with pressure or white without pressure. That is, white without pressure have more risk than the white with pressure, and they basically have a risk of retinal tear and hole is the main risk. So they may need prophylactic treatment. If you have any such lesions, then you may need to undergo frequent retinal evaluations and early treatment if necessary. That's all you need to remember. Yeah. That's all. Yeah.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, everyone, for tuning in with this. I'm Solu Gautam, signing out from today's session, hoping to see you all again in the next one. Stay safe, stay connected. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Okay, thank you, everyone, for being patient.